So as Emily so eloquently read this morning, these three things remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Let me ask you this, only a few of us here, so we can take a poll this morning, right? Now feel free to move closer if you want, or stay where you are. Either way, it's fine. Love is the most important, the greatest thing. What do you think is the second greatest thing? How many of you think it's faith? You got a book for faith? How many of you have a few books for faith?
Family.
Family? Okay. But out of these three, all right, how many think of hope as the second greatest thing? Okay, got one book for hope? Maybe a half book for hope? How many think it's a trick question? You read the bulletin and you saw hope in there, so you think there's got to be hope, right? Well, I don't know. The Bible doesn't tell us which is the second greatest. So I would just speculate. I do have a guess, and unless I forget, I'll tell you what I think at the end of the service. If I forget, remind me. But it just seems to me that hope is kind of like the middle child of these three, you know? Everybody knows the oldest, everybody knows the youngest gets a lot of attention. The middle child kind of gets neglected. So it's kind of like Peter, James, and John, right? We all know about Peter, we all know about John, but we don't really know that much about James. And faith, hope, and love. We all know about the importance of faith. We all know the importance of love. We don't really hear that much about hope, right? You don't hear people preaching that. You just need more hope in your life. And let me tell you how you can build up your hope or strengthen you up in hope. And we say, well, let me tell you how you can get more faith or you need more love. But we don't often hear a lot about hope. And I think part of the problem is that we misunderstand the power of hope. So, for example, if I say, I know that I'm going to heaven, right? That's a statement of faith. We can all get behind that because we support that statement of faith. But if I say, I hope that I'm going to heaven, that kind of sounds like the opposite of faith, doesn't it? It's like, I want to go, but I'm not really sure that I'm going to go. That's a statement of little faith. But look at it from the opposite point of view, okay? If I tell you this guy, he has no faith. He's got no faith, right? He doesn't have any faith that he's going to go to heaven. Well, that's a shame, but it's fixable. I can pray for him. I can witness to him. And I might be able to bring him to a point of faith. But if I say, on the other hand, he has no hope, right? There's no hope that he's going to heaven, then that means game over. Why even bother to pray? He's got no hope. Right? So we see that hope, or in particular, you know, I can talk to you after the service, brother, but right now I need to talk now, okay? All right? Okay. So hope, then, turns out to be an extremely powerful thing. All right? And especially when we see the lack of hope, we see how powerful it is. I think part of the problem is we don't have a full understanding of what the word hope means. Or maybe we have too much of an understanding, because hope in our language has an awful lot of connotations. So what I would like to concentrate on when we think about the word hope is that it's a patient expectation. All right? So we will look at hope as being expectation. And I think that this is one of the areas where Spanish does it better than English. We're the Spanish speakers here today. I know we got at least one, okay? So if I were to say to you, Esperanza, and forgive me, I never studied Spanish. I don't know the language at all, right? So forgive my pronunciation, forgive me if I get it wrong. Esperanza, how would you translate that? What's that? Waiting, okay? Hope, would you translate that as hope? Hope, yeah. So hope and waiting, okay? Esperar. Wait, expect, hope, sort of the same thing. So those two words are linked in the Spanish language, right? When I say hope, when I say expect, when I say wait for, I would pretty much use the same word. And we see that in Romans 8:25. If we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. So what we are hoping for is waiting patiently, right? Hope and waiting, patient expectation are pretty much the same thing. So I was thinking, how would this be translated if I were looking at a Spanish Bible and through the miracle of BibleGateway.com, all right? So help me out with this. So if what we don't see, esperamos, we wait for, all right? With patience, esperamos. It's the same word. Wait and expect. Hope and expect. So those three things are tied together. So hope isn't that sort of wishful thinking. What Paul is talking about when he says that hope will never pass away is that expectation, something that we know that's going to happen, it just hasn't happened yet, and we're waiting for it patiently. Okay, so prophecies are going to cease, tongues are going to be stilled, knowledge is going to pass away. Now when he says knowledge is going to pass away, that doesn't mean there's not going to be any knowledge in heaven, right? What Paul is talking about here is the gift of prophecy, the gift of tongues, and the gift of knowledge. Now we know in part, all right? So we get these words of knowledge that tell us part of the story. When we're in heaven, we're going to know everything, so we're not going to need that gift anymore, okay? But these three things are going to remain: faith, hope, and love. Now we know why we need love. Right in heaven, we're going to love each other, we're going to love God, we're going to spend eternity adoring God. But why would we need faith when we've got God with us, right? When we're right in the presence of God. So here on earth we walk by faith and not by sight. But that doesn't mean that when we have sight, we no longer need the faith. Think about when Jesus was here, all right? He came into his own, and his own received him not. But to as many as received him, to many as believed on his name, he gave the power to become the sons of God. So when Jesus was here, there were people who saw him and did not have faith. And there were also people who saw him and did have faith. So even though we are seeing, we still need to maintain that faith. Faith I define as trust and obedience, right? So we obey God and we trust him even when we see him. Now Satan was up in heaven earlier before man was created. He didn't have that faith. He thought that he could do it better than God, all right? So it's possible to be in God's presence and not believe and not trust, so our faith is not going to die even when we're up in heaven. And similarly with hope, even though now we are hoping for something that we don't have, when we have it, we still live in that hope. We still live in that expectation of eternity with God. When Candace and I were engaged for 10 months and one day, I was living in that hope and that expectation of the day that I was going to be married to Candace, all right? It's here, we've been married for 13 and a half years, and I still wake up with that hope, with that expectation. Hey, I still get to be married to Candace, right? It's a different kind of expectation, it's a different kind of hope. It's a hope that I have, you know, something for something that I already have, a continuation of that. This is going to be for the rest of my life. But it's still living in hope and living in expectation. All right, one more question. Or actually one more set of questions. All right, and JBQers in the room or BQers, you guys log into this. JBQ alumni. So if I said, what is the love chapter? You guys would all answer unequivocally 1 Corinthians 13, right? And if I said, what is the faith chapter? You would similarly chime in Hebrews 11, okay? And if I say, what is the hope chapter? You guys would all say, huh? There's a hope chapter? Well, there's got to be one, right? There's faith, there's hope, and there's love. Those three remain. So if there's a faith chapter and a love chapter, there's pretty much got to be a hope chapter, right? Today we're going to look at Hebrews 6, verses 4 through 20. And the subject is, in fact, the hope chapter. And my purpose today, what I want to get from this, is this thought. Fix your hope on what is eternal. Let's make sure that what our hope is based on is something that's eternal. So please stand with me as we read Hebrews 6, verses 4 through 8. It is impossible for those who have once been enlightened, who have tasted the heavenly gift, who have tasted the goodness of the word of God and the powers of the coming age, and who have fallen away, to be brought back to repentance. To their loss, they are crucifying the Son of God all over again and subjecting him to public disgrace. Land that drinks in the rain often falling on it and that produces a crop useful to those for whom it is farmed receives the blessing of God. But land that produces thorns and thistles is worthless and is in danger of being cursed. In the end, it will be burned. Before you're seated, please join me in reading this prayer. You can read that out loud with me. Lord, open my eyes that I may see wonderful things in your word. Amen. It's based on Psalm 119, verse 18. All right, please be seated. And again, if you feel like moving forward, fine. All right, so what do you think about this passage? Kind of fills you with hope, doesn't it? It's impossible for those who have been enlightened if they fall away to be brought back to repentance. Well, there are a few ways to define things, aren't there? If I were going to give you a definition, say, of bravery, I could give some attributes of bravery, right? I could say, bravery means putting your fears aside. Bravery means stepping up when nobody else is willing to step up. Bravery doesn't mean sitting in the back and waiting for somebody else to move or letting your fears control you. Bravery means overcoming these things, all right? And in the love chapter, 1 Corinthians 13, that's what Paul does. He gives attributes of love. It's patient, it's kind, it does not envy, it does not boast. Another way that I could define bravery, I could give you some examples, right? So a fireman who rushes into a burning building is brave. A soldier who goes and puts his own life at risk to protect other people, he's brave. That 17-year-old boy who pulled the policeman, or was it two policemen, out of the burning car, that's bravery, okay? And this is what we see in the faith chapter. All right, I call him 2H. We don't know who the writer of Hebrews is. We just know that they're the writer or the writers. Sometimes they refer to themselves as we of Hebrews. So we take T-W-O-H, 2-H, call it that, just as a shorthand. If you see me, hear me say that, that's why. So he gives examples by faith, Abel, Enoch, Noah, and all the other people that he talks about. Another way that we can get that we can define a word, I would define bravery, is by comparing and contrasting, right? So there are certain people who never step forward. There are certain people who are afraid of their shadows. There are certain people who are afraid of mice, you know, whatever it might be, spiders, okay? That's not bravery. That's not courage. I give the contrast. Yeah, I could have said they're afraid of clowns, but I guess you could still be brave if you're afraid of clowns. So I give a contrast. I give the opposite. And this is what we see happening here in Hebrews chapter 6. The first thing that we see is the opposite of hope. We get the opposite of hope before we get what hope is, all right? But still, this is a rather difficult passage of scripture, isn't it? What is, if you were to choose one word, what is the word that makes this such a difficult passage of scripture for us to read and to put ourselves behind? Anybody, is there one word that jumps out at you that bothers you there? Impossible, yeah. That's what it is with me, right? Because I have relatives, I have family members who used to serve God, one in particular, and who are no longer serving God. And for me to think that it's impossible for that relative, for those relatives to come back to God, that's a very harsh thought, isn't it? Okay. And we'll come across these passages of scripture that are difficult, that are hard for us to understand. When we come across those, this is how we need to approach it. The first thing about understanding scripture is we have to recognize the fact that scripture is infallible. Right, scripture is not wrong. Scripture is never wrong. This is taken from the fundamental truths of the Assemblies of God, the things that we believe. This is the very first one, and I took this directly from it, this statement itself and the verses of scripture that I used to support it. The scriptures, both Old and New Testaments, are verbally inspired of God and are the revelation of God to man, the infallible, authoritative rule of faith and conduct. All right, so the verses that they give are 2 Timothy 3:15 through 17. Those of you who took the Fundamentals of Faith class or who are in JVQ know this. All scripture is God-breathed, okay? God inspired the very words that were written down. 1 Thessalonians 2:13, when you heard the word of God, you accepted it not as human word, but as it actually is the word of God. So the Bible is not just what people wrote, giving their best opinions, but they were inspired by God to write all of these things, okay? 2 Peter 1:21, prophets, though human, spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. It's the inspiration of the Holy Spirit over and over again we see that dictated the words of God. So since it's impossible for God to lie, everything that's in the Word of God is true. The Word of God is infallible. There aren't any mistakes. There aren't any misprints in it. Right? The Word of God, as it was originally given in its original languages, is infallible. There's nothing wrong with it. So when I come to a passage like this that's difficult for me, I have to acknowledge the fact that it's true, okay? But I just don't understand it. So I have to come to a greater understanding of what that passage means. The second thing that we look at is context. Right? We can't take a verse on its own, we can't take a chapter on its own, but all of the Bible is true at the same time, okay? So what do I mean when I say that it's all true at the same time? You guys are all familiar with the story, do you remember this? The six blind people who were trying to describe an elephant. And the first one touches the tusk and says, oh, the elephant is like a spear. And says, no, he's like a snake, because he's holding the trunk. And one of them grabs his ear and says, no, he's like a curtain. The other one says, he's like a wall, he's like a tree trunk. And then the last one says, he's like a rope. Okay, pretty implausible story, but we get the point, right? Which one of these guys was right when it came to describing an elephant? None of them was right. They were all wrong. You can't just take one aspect of the elephant and say, this is what an elephant is like. And similarly, we can't just take one scripture and say, this is the nature of God, this is the truth of God, right? We have to understand scripture in the context of all of scripture. And that's why it's important for us to understand, to get a knowledge of all of the Word of God, okay? But that's difficult. I mean, there are people who spend their lifetimes studying just one chapter, studying just one verse, all right? What hope do we have of learning all of the Word of God, much less putting together that whole picture? I kind of feel like that blind man. I know all these different parts of the elephant, but I can't visualize how it all works together. What hope is there for us? Well, the hope comes from the fact that God's Word is inspired, okay? As we said, all Scripture is God-breathed. And where God breathes, there is life. The same God who breathed into Adam and made Adam become a living being, the same God in Ezekiel 37 breathed into the dry bones and formed them into a great army, breathed into the Word of God, okay? And so the Word of God is alive and active. So the same God who inspired the writing of the Scripture inspires our reading of the Scripture. Last time I was with you, I mentioned my life verse, which is, oh, how I love your law, I meditate on it day and night. Well, the New Testament counterpart to that, Paul writes to Timothy, reflect on what I'm saying, for the Lord will give you insight into all this. And that, to me, is the prescription for understanding the Word of God, understanding difficult passages like this. Just reflect on them in the presence of God. Allow the Holy Spirit to reveal Himself. Allow Him to reveal His Word to you. He has a desire for you to understand His Word. James says, if any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, right? God doesn't say, I can't believe that idiot doesn't understand this simple passage of Scripture. No, He doesn't find fault. He gives wisdom to all who seek it. Our only responsibility is to seek wisdom, is to seek direction from the Word of God. All right, so we reflect on the Word of God. We reflect on this passage and what we know of the Word of God. And that's how we come to terms with things like this this word impossible in that passage, Hebrews 6, verses 4 through 8. It's interesting, long before I knew that I was going to be speaking on this subject, Becky and Mandy and I were riding up to Resurrection Life, and we were discussing this. And Becky mentioned Jesus's encounter with the rich young ruler, right? And remember, after he left, Jesus said, the disciples said, well, then who can be saved? And Jesus said, with man this is impossible, but with God all things are impossible. So when we see 2H saying it's impossible, right, we have to recognize that this impossibility isn't on God's side. The impossibility is on man's side. Right? God has made it possible for everybody to come to a knowledge of Him. Joel 2:32, it's repeated in Acts, it's also repeated in Romans. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. God has made provision for everybody's salvation. All right? The only variable is the human being, it's a human element. God gives us the choice how we respond to the call that God has on our lives. All right? So, in Deuteronomy, one of the last things that Moses said, speaking for God, I put before you life and death, blessings and curses, choose life. The choice is in our hands, right? We have to understand that when it says it's impossible, it doesn't mean that it's impossible for God to save. The impossibility is on the human side. But that still doesn't make us feel a lot better, right? Because that still says we're still left with this impossible situation that my unsaved relative or my backslidden relative is in. Okay, so we got to look a little bit deeper. So it goes on to say in Hebrews chapter 4, land that drinks in rain often falling on it and that produces a crop receives a blessing, but land that produces thistles is cursed and in danger of being cursed. And then this phrase, in the end, we have to understand what that word, that phrase, in the end means. Okay, so we talked about the fact that God does His part, He pours down the rain, and the response is for the land. Is it going to produce good crop or is it going to produce thistles? And if it doesn't produce a good crop, it's going to be burned. So this reminds us of a couple of things. Remember Isaiah chapter 5, when Isaiah sings the song of his beloved planted a vineyard? And he looked for good grapes, but the vineyard produced bad grapes. And he said, what more could I have done for my vineyard than I did? I'm going to tear it up. I'm going to destroy it. Let the ground be used for something else. Jesus elaborates on that when he gives the parable of the fig tree in Luke chapter 13, verses 6 through 8, but there's a little bit of a difference. The master comes and says, why am I even bothering with this land? Tear it out and, you know, let it be destroyed. And then a servant comes to him and says, sir, leave it alone for one more year. I'll dig around it and fertilize it. If it bears fruit next year, fine. If not, then cut it down. All right? So this shows us the ministry of Jesus. And this is how we understand what it says, in the end it will be burned. Okay? Because the first time Jesus came, he came as Savior. He did not come as judge. John 3:17, God did not send his Son in the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved, to save the world through him. All right, so that's when Jesus comes and says, let me work on it a little bit more. And then if it doesn't produce, then you can destroy it. Okay. The second time Jesus comes, Romans says he's going to be returning, you know, Christ the righteous judge, he's going to be returning as the judge, to judge those who have done wrong and those who have done right. Okay? So, until the second coming, until we meet Jesus, until somebody dies, or until Jesus comes back, there's still hope. Ecclesiastes 9:4, with all who live, there is hope. So, in the end, it will be burned. That's when the game's over. All right? There's still hope while they're still alive. Okay? But where does that hope lie? When it says it's impossible for those who have fallen away to be brought back to repentance. So again, we have to look at this phrase, we have to look at the Word of God in a little bit more depth. And what I want to concentrate on is that those two words, to be brought back to repentance. Okay? So what's the picture there of being brought back to repentance? Well, there we see the picture of the lost sheep. Remember Jesus gives the parable of the lost sheep? And he says the shepherd goes and he leaves the 99 behind him, and he comes back and he carries it on his shoulder. All right, so that being brought back means that, you know, you've wandered away, you've gotten lost, all right? And then God brings you back, he puts you on his shoulder, and he carries you back into the fold. That's how God brings back people who have drifted away, okay? People who, you know, maybe their prayer lives have become cold, all of a sudden they find themselves not serving God. But this is a different situation than what Hebrews is talking about when it says those who have fallen away. The writer talks about it in a little bit more depth in Hebrews chapter 10. If we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment and a raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. All right. So this isn't somebody who's wandered away, somebody who has drifted away from the flock. This is someone who has deliberately turned his back on God. Okay. And you can understand there's no need for the shepherd to bring back that sheep, because what's that sheep going to do? He's just going to run away again. He's just going to rebel again. Okay, so that's what God is saying. It's impossible for that person to be brought back. The Bible says, my spirit will not always contend with humans because they are mortal. Right? God isn't going to keep playing that game, bringing you back just to have you rebel again. So we understand that it's impossible for that person to be brought back. Well, where then is the hope for that person who has rebelled, that person who has deliberately kept sinning? We talked about the lost sheep. Jesus also talks about the lost son, also known as the prodigal son. All right, so what did he do? He rebelled against his father. His father didn't try to get him to stay because he knew that there was no purpose in it. There was no reason to try to talk him out of it when he was unhappy and he was dissatisfied. So what did his father do? He let him taste life apart from his father's house. And he waited for him. And then when the son reached his lowest point, when he said, man, even the pigs in my father's house are living better than I do, that's when he came back. All right? And so that's the hope for those of us who have friends whom we're praying for, right? Relatives, whoever it might be. Never stop praying for them, because God hasn't given up on them. He's not going to go after them and chase them, but he's going to wait for them to reach the bottom and come back. Right? In the Old Testament, there's a prophecy of Jeremiah. Remember how the people kept rebelling against the Lord? And God said, you know what? I'm not going to bring you back anymore. I'm going to let you see what it's like to go and serve another land, right? To go and serve other gods. You're going to go and be taken over by these kingdoms, and you'll find out it wasn't so bad serving God. Paul talks about Hymenaeus and Alexander. He says, I have handed them over to Satan to be taught not to blaspheme. So why did he hand them over to Satan? Was it to punish them? Was it because he was mad at them? No, because that was how they would learn not to blaspheme. All right, so that's the hope that we have. It doesn't mean that it's impossible for these people to come back to a knowledge of God. It just means that they have to reach that low point, and they have to come back on their own, because otherwise they're just going to keep rebelling. So that's where the hope is. Let me ask you this. We had to do a lot of work to get to that point, didn't we? Right? Because it can be kind of depressing and it can be kind of hurtful for us to think that, you know, these people who have backslidden don't have a chance to get back into God's favor. So why even bring this up? Why even put it in the Word of God if it's going to be so confusing? All right, I'm going to draw, through the magic of PowerPoint, an elephant. Okay? So we talked about elephants before. This is my elephant. Filling him in. There's the ear. There's the eye. All right, what do you think of my elephant? Pretty good elephant, right?
What's wrong with his trunk?
No? Some of you don't like my elephant? Don't worry about hurting my feelings, would you say? No trunk, right? Not really an elephant if it doesn't have the trunk. Okay? And it's the same thing with the Word of God. If we leave this out, we have an incomplete picture of the truth of God. And that's why it's in there, right? God wants to show us the whole truth. And I think it's also important for us to recognize that it's in there for another reason. It's in there as a deterrent. You know, sometimes we get casual about our relationship with God and we think, well, God's always going to take me back. Well, that's true. But it's hard for me to come back. Once I get caught up in the world, right, it's hard for me to change my heart and to change my mind. So in order to keep me from being relaxed in my relationship with God so that I start doing things that are destructive and wandering away from God or openly rebelling against God, right, 2H, the writer of Hebrews, uses words such as impossible, right, and talks about what happens if we deliberately keep on sinning as a deterrent to help us keep from behaviors that are bad. Okay? So, let's go on. We talked about the no hope. Let's look at the opposite side of the coin. Even though we speak like this, dear friends, we are convinced of better things in your case, the things that have to do with salvation. Let's just take a moment and appreciate that phrase, convinced of better things. It's no secret that I have what might be called an abnormal love for the Word of God, and every once in a while, a phrase like this just hits me really hard. And most of the time I control myself. Sometimes I just have to email Candace and tell her, that's the most beautiful phrase in the world, and she kind of puts up with it, because that's what you have to do when you're married to me, right? But, I mean, I just remember being bowled over by this phrase. It's just such a wonderful phrase. We are convinced of better things. Now, what is 2H talking about here? He's making reference to another passage of Scripture in Hebrews, right? In the faith chapter. Faith is confidence in what we hope for, okay? Convinced is confidence of what we hope for. We're hoping for better things. And assurance, being convinced of what we do not see, those better things that we haven't seen yet. So convinced of better things, he's talking about faith and hope. And we see that there is a link between faith and hope, okay? So there is that faith-hope connection. And then he goes a little bit further and says, things that have to do with salvation. And what we'll notice in the faith chapter is that every instance of faith that is cited there is tied to a hope of salvation. So, plot twist, Hebrews 11 is not just the faith chapter, it's also the hope chapter. Hebrews 11 turns out to be the hope chapter. You guys thought it was Hebrews 6 all this time, but it turns out to be Hebrews 11. Okay, so let's look at a couple of them. By faith, Noah, when warned about the things not yet seen, in holy fear built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and became the heir of righteousness that is in keeping with faith. All right, so Noah had faith for the salvation of the ark, but look at that, it doesn't end there. Okay, he became the heir of righteousness by faith. So his faith wasn't just in that miracle that God saved him and his family and all those animals in the ark. His faith was looking forward to something that was eternal. Okay, similarly, Abraham, when called to a place that he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went. So by faith, he received this inheritance on this world. But also, he was looking forward to the city whose foundations and architect and builder is God. Alright? So things that have to do with salvation. Abraham's faith wasn't just for the inheritance that his descendants would receive in the Middle East. Alright? It was that inheritance that he had in heaven. His faith was placed in heaven. And we're going to see the importance of this in the point right after this. But what 2H says in verse 13, all these people were still living by faith when they died. Now, I used to think of this when I was younger as, man, that's so sad. They never got the thing that they were hoping for. But actually, this is a great and a wonderful verse, and this is the verse that should be our motivation, right? It's not just the things on earth that are our hope, but we have a hope even after we die, right? Their faith didn't end when they died. Their hope wasn't just placed on the things of this world. They still had a hope. They hadn't lost that at the time of their death. They were still living by faith when they died. Okay, and we're going to talk about that again, the importance of the eternal faith. Not this point, but the point after this one. Actually, a little bit of this point. Okay, so, God is not unjust. He will not forget your work and the love you have shown him as you have helped the people and continue to help them. Now look at that. Things that have to do with salvation. And then he's talking about God will not forget your work and the people whom you have helped. So is he talking about justification by works? Right? God doesn't forget your works. Sounds a little bit odd, doesn't it? Well, of course he's not talking about justification by works. But what he's reminding us of, we're familiar with the fires of hell, right? 2H here was reminding us of the fires of heaven. Okay? Familiar with the fires of heaven? Because not only are the unrighteous going to be judged, but Paul makes it plain, Revelation makes it plain, that the righteous are going to be judged as well. If you look at 1 Corinthians 3, if anyone builds on this foundation using gold, costly stones, silver, wood, hay, or straw, the work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test the quality of each person's work. If what he has built, what has been built survives, the builder will receive reward. If it is burned up, the builder will suffer loss, but yet will be saved, even though only as one escaping through the flames. It's going to be a sad day in heaven when we stand before the Lord and the things that we invested so much in just burn up. They weren't worth anything. They had no eternal value, right? So let's say that God gives me the ability to be very convincing and persuasive. Now, I can persuade people to come to know God, or I can persuade people to get more involved in the church or to pursue their gifts, right, or to minister, you know. Or I can pursue them to invest in my pyramid scheme and make me a lot of money, okay? That's investing in the things of this world, and those are the things that are going to burn up, right? Whatever talent God has given me, if God has given me a talent to sing, and we all know that he hasn't, you might not know that, but it's true, all right? And I'm using that to increase my own personal wealth, rather than to bless the word of God, the work of God. Yeah, I might make it to heaven, but all of that money, all of that time that I've been investing in, all that talent is just going to burn up. It's going to be of no value. It's not going to have any eternal value. Okay. But we have hope. We're convinced of better things in your case. Okay. This is why, well, first of all, this is the importance of having a hope that's eternal. Right? As I was saying, our hope isn't placed on this world. If my hope is in this world, then I'm going to invest in this world. If I think that this world is everything, then all that I do is going to make myself comfortable, make myself happy, make myself, you know, get to the top here on this world. All right? But if my hope is in what's eternal, I'm going to invest in things that matter. I'm not going to look after my own comfort. I'm going to look after what's best for the kingdom of God. I'm going to be investing in the next generation. I'm going to be investing in churches. I'm going to be investing in missions, my time, my energy, my finances. Right? All those things are the things that are going to last. Jesus said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And if my treasure is here on earth, when I get to heaven, it's going to burn up because it wasn't worth anything. All right? But all who have this hope in them, John says, purify themselves just as he is pure. It's that hope that we have for eternity that changes our behavior. It makes it so that I invest in those things that last, invest in those things that are eternal. So where is my heart? Where is my hope? Because my hope is inextricably linked to my faith and to my investments. All right, finally, brethren and sisters, we want each of you to show the same diligence to the very end, so that what you hope for may be fully realized. We don't want you to become lazy, but to imitate those who through faith and patience inherit what has been promised. We have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. It enters the inner sanctuary behind the curtain, where our forerunner Jesus has entered on our behalf. He has become a high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. So a couple of things to point out here. First, that link of faith and patience. And as I said, I view hope as patient expectation. Okay? So here we see faith and that patience working together for what has been promised. What has been promised is that for which we hope. All right. So patience, faith and hope are inextricably linked. And this is true. When hope dies, it takes faith with it. A lot of times what we see as a crisis of faith is in fact a crisis of hope. All right. I debated for a long time whether or not to use this example. And Eagles fans, any Eagles fans here? Thankfully there are not a lot of people here this morning. I love Eagles fans, I really do. I have no disrespect for Eagles fans at all. All right, so this is not a jibe against Eagles fans. And you have to understand, when I started working on this sermon, the Eagles were 9-3. Everybody knew they were going to the Super Bowl, right? My team was 7-5, and they were going to stay home and watch it. So this wasn't meant as a dig against Eagles fans. And if it's too soon, I apologize. But
it's too soon.
Here's the thing about Eagles fans. Eagles fans are people of incredible faith, right? I mean, I wish that I had the faith of Eagles fans. I've been in Philadelphia for 25 and a half years, almost 26 years, right? And every year, this is the year, right? We got the right coach now. We got the quarterback now. We got the dream team now. Come on, you got to get on the bandwagon because this is the year for the Eagles, right? And that faith lasts as long as there's hope, as long as hope lasts. But as soon as the Eagles are mathematically eliminated, you know, gotta get rid of the coach. He's the worst coach ever. Gotta get rid of the quarterback. What are we doing with, you know, McNabb or Cunningham or, you know, Michael Vick, right? These guys were all their saviors and then they threw him out on the scrap heap, right? Because as soon as hope dies, faith dies. Your faith goes with it, all right? So what does that look like in a biblical sense? John the Baptist had an incredible pedigree. John the Baptist, Luke tells us, was filled with the Spirit of God, filled with the Holy Spirit, even in his mother's womb. Okay? Verses 41 and 44, when Mary came to see Elizabeth, his mom, right? The child within her, John the Baptist, still in her womb, leapt for joy. He was so excited. Now, you know, mothers get those feelings all the time. Ooh, the baby leapt, right? But this, remember, this is written by the inspiration of God. He leapt in response to the fact that Mary was there. Okay? And then when Jesus came, when John the Baptist was baptizing, right, John says, I know who he is because I saw the Spirit of God descend on him. I wouldn't have known that that was he, except for the fact that the Spirit of God descended on him. So he had a very clear knowledge of who Jesus was, that Jesus was the Christ. He had that recognition. And yet, we see him in Luke chapter 17 sending his disciples to ask Jesus, are you the one we're supposed to wait for, or was there somebody else? So this is a crisis of faith in the life of John the Baptist, but what we have to understand is that it wasn't just that his faith disappeared, it was that he lost hope. Now, he was looking for a Messiah who was going to restore the kingdom to Israel, who was going to throw off the yoke of Roman oppression. Okay? But here, John found himself in prison, and he didn't see Jesus doing anything to restore the nationhood of Israel. So he lost hope in that thing that he had been hoping for, and that's what caused him to lose his faith. Now, the Bible says that God will raise up a prophet in the spirit of Elijah who is going to go forward and prepare the way for Jesus. And that's the prophecy that John the Baptist fulfilled. And Jesus said, if you're willing to accept it, John the Baptist is Elijah, okay, the reincarnation of Elijah. So, point I'm making there is that John the Baptist is really living up to his legacy because Elijah before him had a crisis of hope, which impacted his faith. Remember that? Elijah had this incredible miracle. He faced all the prophets of Baal and said, the God who responds by fire is the one who is the true God. All right? All those prophets called all day long and nothing happened. And then God sent down fire, burned up Elijah's sacrifice, and they rounded up all the prophets of Baal and they killed him. What happened in the next chapter? Jezebel said, as surely as, you know, my name is Jezebel, Elijah's going to die. And Elijah runs away and he says, Lord, take away my life. Just kill me now. There's no reason for me to live anymore, right? He had a crisis of faith, but it was really a crisis of hope. Okay? So the same thing happened. The thing that he had hoped for, the destruction of Baal, That was behind him. And after that, he lost his faith. So this shows us, in two examples, why it's important for us to have our faith in something that's eternal. Okay? Because John was looking at what was going to happen here on earth. Jesus was going to come and he was going to restore the Jewish nation. Right? When that didn't happen, it was a crisis of hope and a crisis of faith for John. Elijah won that great victory, but all of a sudden that was in the past. Okay? And there was nothing that he was hoping for. There was no other hope for him to stake himself in. So he had a crisis of faith. Now contrast that with Noah. When we talk about Noah, what did the writer of Hebrews say in Hebrews 11? He was looking for the righteousness for the salvation that was eternal. Right? He wasn't just looking at the fact that God was going to save him and his family in the ark. If that had been the case, all the time that there were twists and turns in the building of the ark, all the time people were ridiculing him, there was still no rain, he would have had a crisis of faith. He would have had a crisis of hope. And then after God had delivered him, he would have a crisis of hope. Well, you know, what's next? I spent the last however many years building this ark. Now what do I do? You know, there's nothing else to look forward to. And unfortunately, these are the traps that we can fall into ourselves, right? Let's say that God calls me to plant a church or to start a new area of ministry or to go overseas in missions, all right? So that's what I'm working for. That's what I'm looking towards. Now, if there are twists and turns in that vision, if all of a sudden things go bad and I'm not able to raise funds, people aren't attending the new church, whatever else it might be, then that's going to affect my hope. This thing that I've been hoping for isn't coming true. And when that happens, it affects my faith. Okay? So as long as my faith is in something that has to do with what's temporal, what's on this world, it's going to be subject to ups and downs, to ebbs and flows. That's why no matter what God has promised me, my faith has to be in what's eternal. Or the other thing that could happen is, you know, I start that church, I launch that new ministry, I go to the missions field, and now what? Right? I got to wait for the next hope to come along, or else I start questioning myself. Did God really call me? You know, what's there to happen to me now? I go into a dry spell because the thing that I've been putting all my energy for, it's now behind me. Okay, so that's why my hope has to be built on things that are eternal. Okay, I can't stake it on things here below. It always has to be that eternal faith in what God is going to do. So this is why we sing. This, if I were my father-in-law, or if I were Pastor Finney, we would sing this right now, but again, nobody wants to hear me sing. This is why that song, and if you're a baby boomer like me, Candace hates it when I say I'm a baby boomer because she doesn't like to think that she married somebody old, but I am a baby boomer. If you're a baby boomer like me, you know this is the solid rock. If you are, what are you guys, millennials, Generation X, you know this is Cornerstone, is that what it's called? Cornerstone, right? My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. So it's not any of those things along the way. It's not those great visions, those beautiful things. Yeah, those are wonderful. It's great that God gives us those visions, but that's not where my hope is. All right? My hope is always in what's eternal, because that's the only way that my hope will survive. All right? When darkness veils his lovely face, or when darkness seems to hide his face, I think it is in Cornerstone, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. What is the veil? Anybody? What's the veil within which my anchor holds? What's that? The Holy of Holies. Very good. So Hebrews, it says, we have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. It enters into the inner sanctuary behind the curtain. Now Edward Mote, who wrote The Solid Rock, probably read it in the King James where it says, which entereth into that within the veil. Okay, so Edward Mote was actually quoting Hebrews 6. Who knew? Emily knew. Good job, Emily. Right? He knew his Bible. My anchor holds within the veil. That anchor for the soul is within the veil. It's within the Holy of Holies where God tore down the curtain and gave us the entryway. So what does that mean? What does that look like? When he talks about it enters the inner sanctuary behind the curtain or behind the veil. Well, Paul talks about that in Romans 5, verses 1 through 5. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace through God, or it can be translated, if you look at the footnote, let us have peace through God and our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into the grace by which we stand. So that inner sanctuary is this grace. We have access behind the veil into the grace of God, that eternal grace. And let us boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but let us also glory in our sufferings, For we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, or in the NIV 84, hope does not disappoint us, all right? If our hope is in that which is eternal, if our hope is in God's grace, if our hope is behind the veil, we are not put to shame, we are not disappointed, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. So, fix your hope on what is eternal, all right? We will never lose hope if we anchor our hope in that which is eternal. So when you start to feel like this, my tears have been my food day and night, while people say to me, where is your God? I remember how I used to go to the house of God under the protection of the Mighty One with shouts and praise and praise and joy. Then say to yourself, why are you downcast, my soul? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God. I will yet praise Him, my Savior and my God. If my hope is eternal, my faith is eternal. Okay, so that gets the answer to this question. Which is the second greatest? Faith or hope? Well, as we said, faith and hope are inextricably linked, aren't they? So we can look at them as being conjoined twins. The twin on the left is faith, the twin on the right is hope. Those are their names. Which one is greater? They're both twins, right? There's the older brother, who's the older sister who's loved, and then there's the twins who are conjoined in their faith and hope. Can't separate one from the other. If you've got faith, you've got hope. If you've got hope, you've got faith. Let's make sure that our faith is fixed on that which is eternal.